when we imagine we are there, who is it imagining? Who is imagining we are there? Obviously not the physical body. And who is imagining? And how do we imagine? There are two kinds of imaginations. One is called sensory imagination and one is called causal imagination. The sensory imagination takes with us the power of the five senses of perception. When we imagine we can see that painting, even when we are not looking at it, we are using the power of vision, the power of seeing in imagination. When we can hear something which is not being heard, if we can hear the thought of it, supposing we heard the church bells in the morning and we want to remember, did we hear it? And we remember, we actually hear it. This imagining that we are hearing the same thing again, this hearing is the sensory power of hearing that we are transferring to imagination. Similarly, all the five senses of perception that we use in the physical body can be used in imagination. When we use all the five powers of senses, five senses, when we use in imagination, that is called the astral body. There is no such thing as an astral body besides this. I have never found any astral body that is other than the power of using the senses without the physical. People talk like it's a very strange, hidden thing. Imagination, if it can fully utilize the five senses, can take you out of this body, take you anywhere you want to in the world, or out of the world. Even in terms of reality, what is real, we don't know. We are grounded in this belief that this physical matter alone is real. Why? We can check it out. This table is real? Well, firstly, I can see it. But if you confuse me by saying you are having a delusion, you are having hallucination, I can knock on it. No, it's fine. I can touch it. I can cross-check one sense against the other and prove it is real. If all the five senses are operating on the same principle of imagination, then checking one with the other won't make any difference. I'll keep on proving the reality of it. This physical reality has become so real for us, so much a part of our life, it is impossible, except with the grace of the Lord and with some great miraculous experiences within, to loosen our belief that this physical world is the only real one. It's very difficult. We may say, this is illusion, this is unreal, but when somebody comes and hits us, we hit back as real. If somebody comes and gives great talks to you, oh, this world is illusion. Go and insult that person. And if he gets angry and mad at you, what are you getting mad at? It's illusion. I am only illusion attacking you. And see how he gives up all his talk that he has been giving. This tall talk, this world is illusion, does not take away from the experience we are having that this is real. Why are we taking this experience? Because our attention has got so earthed into this physical matter. It has got so much joined up with physical matter, so tied up with ropes with physical matter and physical things that we have taken them as real. Let's have a little experiment in which, while you are sitting on your chairs, you imagine that you walk up the aisle or walk up through the rows, come up and shake my hand. Shake my hand and go back and sit on your chair. Would you like to do this? Okay, so while you are there, all of you imagine that you are going to walk up to me, look at me, shake my hand, say, how are you doing? Don't wait for an answer and go back and sit on your chair. Do it right now. You can do it with eyes closed, eyes open, your choice. Use your imagination to walk up, shake my hand. So I've kept my hand out. Nobody misses it. Nobody misses it. When you are done and gone back, raise your hands. Thank you. Thank you. How many missed? Anybody still waiting? Okay, try again. Just back. Okay. Anybody still left out? Did you all come and shake my hands? Please raise your hands if you did. Thank you. It is pure imagination. Did you know it was pure imagination? Please raise your hands if you knew it was imaginary. Please raise your hands if you think it was real. Some felt it real too. Now, who is right? The majority, I suppose. The truth is, you did come and shake my hand, but with part of your attention, very small part of your attention. The rest of your attention stayed where you were sitting. Maybe 85-90% of attention was where you were sitting. 5%, 6%, 10% went and shook my hand. Therefore, that reality remained where it was. If you are able to take it above 50%, 51% of your attention had come here, you would have said that you came here and imagined you were still sitting there. That's the truth of our world. That is the truth of our sensory perception of what this world is. And we don't know it. This feeling that this matter which we can feel is more real than imagination is created by the percentage of attention we are giving to it. Nothing else. And you walk to me with your astral bodies. Did you know that? Because the other bodies were sitting there. These are the astral bodies people talk of. They make so much of this. Oh, we had an out-of-body experience you all had just now a few minutes ago. And it was exactly the same body that anybody else has out-of-body experience with, which you just had. There is no other astral body except the one you just experienced. Why make so much? Make it an occult science and going out-of-body and astral flights. You just had an astral flight. When the senses can travel by themselves, that is the astral body. In fact, it is not an astral body, it's just a system. Now what has happened is, the same sensory system, which is part of consciousness, not part of physical body, this ability to see is not being created by these eyes. The ability to see is being created by consciousness. The eyes are being used for seeing. But the consciousness can see without eyes too, as you just saw. What we have done is, that by planting that consciousness into the body, by putting the astral or sensory body, fitting it into the physical body, we make this physical body alive. And we feel it's real and true, this is our self. But the sensory body is not the self, it's not the soul. It is only another body like this one. Just like this body makes us feel this is the self, the sensory or astral body also makes us feel that is the self. That is also a body just like this, not reality. The senses are not ourselves. The senses are one way of experiencing the functions of self. This is the sensory or astral imagination. There's another imagination which you can have in pure thought. You don't imagine you have gone or done this. You just think you are there. Have you ever done that? That you can think, can you think you are in watching the war in Iraq? You watch nothing. You're just there. What does that mean? This conceptual possibility, this way of going by thought wherever we like, this way of transferring our location just by thought is called causal imagination and comes from the pure mind and not from the astral body. Astral body plays no role. But sometimes we combine the two. The causal thought process we combine with the sensory process and the causal and astral travel together and make it even more realistic. But even the mind and thoughts that travel are not ourselves. They're just another body. Just another cover. We are consciousness that is using these bodies, using these mechanics, using these systems to have experience. To be able to reach that form, we have to go step by step. We cannot jump these steps and say, all right, I don't want to look at my astral body. I don't want to look at my causal body. I just want to go straight and know my soul. You can't do it. Because your experience is such that when you go within this body, what is the astral body looks like your soul. that you found your soul. Only when you go within the astral body, you find out the causal self and say, that is the soul. Only when you go within the causal self and find pure spiritual self, you say, that is the soul. Even after finding the soul, when you find that the individual soul has no place, that individuality is a body, you find totality, you say, ah, that's me. But then you can't say me because there's nobody else except me. So there's no me or self left at all. There's all universality. So this experience goes stage by stage, gradually, as we go in. So don't hasten to come to a conclusion that just because you can free yourself from the body or have seen your reality inside, you have found the ultimate spiritual self. That's further deep within, but always within. In every one of these forms, you will find that your truth is within that. To give you a further experience of this, let's do an exercise, putting all the sense perceptions into the space behind to make it more realistic. In this exercise, which we are going to do now, we build the same platform. We advance from the previous exercise. Build the same platform. Take a nice chair. It costs you nothing. Take the best chair which you ever saw. That's one good advantage of imagination. If you don't, first of all, pay, if you want to pay, you can pay in imaginative dollars. So buy the best chair, grab the best chair, imagine the best chair, put it in the center of the hall, within your head, behind the eyes, at the third eye center, just behind these two tips of my fingers. If these are the eyeballs, and where they meet, this is precisely, you can see your hand and see like this triangle is formed like this. The eyes, the third eye center is placed behind them like this. It's in the center. If you were to draw a line between the ears, and draw two lines straight behind the eyes and form a bridge on that line between the ears. In the middle of the bridge, if you sit, you are just at the third eye center. Now this exercise, you imagine you have next to you, I know many of you like this exercise, what we are going to have next to you. Next to you, a small table on which is a vase or a vase of flowers. Beautiful flowers of your own choice. And next to it is a small plate of dessert, your favorite eating thing. If you don't like dessert, you can have a salty snack. You pick your choice. Imagine you have a snack next to you, you have flowers next to you, and you sit in the middle. And when I tell you, at that time, pick up the flowers, smell them, look at them, and put them back on the table. And when I tell you again, pick up the snack, use this imaginative spoon or with your hand, taste it, eat it, look at it, and put it back on the table again. Let's begin. Imagine you are in the center of your head. On the side, you have a table on which there's a bunch of flowers and a nice snack sitting. And sit comfortably in the center of the head. Be conscious of the table on the side. Now pick up the flowers. Hold them in front of you. Look at the flowers. Smell them. And put them back on the table. Now pick up the plate of the snack. Enjoy your snack or dessert. Taste it. Look at it again. Put it back on the table. Keep your eyes closed till I count five. If any one of you has missed, do it now again. One, two, three, four, five. Open your eyes and come out this side now. Was it easy this time? How many of you could see the flowers? Please raise your hands. How many of you could smell the flowers? How many of you could see the dessert or the snack? Thank you. How many of you could taste it? Thank you. So you were able to touch, taste, smell, all these different imaginative experiences. Did you like it? Okay, anyone would like to share? Did anybody see some unusual flowers? Anybody saw some unusual flowers? A pretty flower, yes. You'd like to share what kind of flowers?
Kind of jagged. Kind of like purple and jagged with...
You didn't imagine those kinds. Did you imagine them? Or they just came like that?
Okay.
Anybody else saw flowers that didn't want to imagine like that? The color or the shape? Yes?
I tried to imagine rose, but instead this purple flower came out.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Mm-hmm. Didn't they smell good? How many of you had difficulty in smelling the flowers? Okay, just a few. Next time you'll smell. You didn't pick up the fragrant flowers then. Okay, what about dessert?
Delicious.
What kind of dessert? Yes.
I have chocolate pudding.
Did you like it?
Oh, yeah.
Tasted good?
I may have it again later.
No calories. No calories in this cake. Okay. Who else would like to share the dessert? Yes. Oh, good. Anybody else? Yes?
I had to change my snack because it was a chocolate mousse.
You had to change it?
So I needed to eat.
Okay. Okay, the purpose of this exercise was to show that the sensory perceptions are not physical. That this constant feeling in us that we have to have physical ears, physical taste buds, physical things to have an experience of senses is not true. All the sensory experiences are built into our imaginative, our ethereal, our astral self, which has all the capabilities of doing it. In fact, this body restricts how much it can do, not enhances it. But we are used to it, therefore we think it is this body that does all this. Yes.
But while you're telling us of what we're going to do, we're already imagining what it is that we're going to be doing. So actually, haven't we already done it twice? Isn't it the second time?
Yeah. How many of you did it two times? Once on your own and once... You see, so many did it like... Yeah. So you had already done it by the time I said so. Because before we started, you were already prepared. The moment you closed your eyes, you went through it. Some of you did more than twice. But the purpose was not that you have to eat pudding there. The purpose was to see that consciousness holds the key to these sensory experiences. Did anybody have any flowers that you have not seen before? No memory involved. But did you remember something that was new? Okay. What about you? Was there something new that you have not seen before? Anybody else? Did you taste anything that was not from memory? Anybody had or that was all remembered? Puddings and pies. Most of the imagination was from memory. But sometimes you try to imagine one thing, something else can come up. The longer you stay there, the more things will come up that you have never experienced before at all. This space has experiences from which memories are created. You'll find that out later. Yes.
Memory is still there. I can't get rid of it.
That's true. Still there. So the memory of this experience is there, or the earlier one?
No, this one with the dessert and the flowers is very vivid in my mind.
It's as vivid as would be if you had really had this. Therefore, if you are an objective analyst of consciousness, you would not distinguish between this memory and the memory of a real physical experience. That's true. There is no real difference. We are trying to impose a difference by our prejudged, preconditioned knowledge of what this physical reality is the only reality. That's why we are trying to put that memory separate from this. Otherwise, there's no difference. The memory of this experience is identical. And after you have eaten the pudding, in imagination or otherwise, the only thing left with you is memory. And memory is the same in both cases. So the continuous experience you can have, either astrally or physically, the continuity of it is memory. And there's no difference. But what I was going to tell you, it's not directly connected with our exercises here, but is an element of knowledge that you may like to accept at this time, that all the experiences that we have in this world are coming from the astral form, in the astral self, all sensory experiences, even of the physical body. When we actually physically take something, we say, I had today, this morning, at breakfast, I ate this. At this time, it looks like memory. Because we ate in the morning, we are not eating now. Actually, even when you ate, it was memory. Now, that's difficult, a tough one. But I'll get back to you on that sometime. That even when you actually ate, it was still memory. But I'll take a few minutes to put you in touch with that subject. For those who want to think on those lines. The subject is that memory is related to time. Memory can only be recalled from the past. We don't use the word memory for something that is still to happen. We can't say, I can remember what is happening tomorrow. It doesn't fit in like this. The word memory is used to make a statement about what comes into consciousness as having already happened in the past, and we are recalling it and saying, yeah, I can remember, therefore it had already happened, and now I'm remembering it. You cannot remember if there is no linear time like this. Unless there is a time in which there is a past and a present and a future, you can have no memory. Memory requires as a precondition that you must have a past, a present, and a future. When you look at this nature of time, you will find that we as conscious human beings have never lived in any other time except present. We never lived in the past. We can only remember the past. The past looked real when that was present. We can't live in the past. Living in the past means use of memory. So to be able to live in the past requires memory. There's no other way. There is no other way whatsoever of living in the past except through memory in the present. The memory must operate in the present in order to live in the past. When we are living in the present, what is the present? How much time do we have in the present to live? How much time do we have in the present to live now? We have no time. The moment we say time, it's become past. Before we said it, it was future. We never got time to have present. And yet, we only live in the present. All the memory is in the present. We can't recall a thing except in the now. And now has no time. And without time, there can be no memory. It's a very strange situation for us. We are only living in a timeless present. Not by choice. We have no control over it. We can't escape this now. Has anybody ever escaped? Can somebody say, I don't want to live in the now? What can you do? You can either live in the memory of the past, but when you remember, recall the memory, you are still recalling it in the now. Or you can live in the hope of a future, anticipation of a future. That hoping and anticipating is also in the now. So, you create a past for memory in the now. You create hopes and fears of the future in the now. Both are taking place in the now, but they have no time. Now has no time. How can you possibly have experience of time that I sat there for 1 hour when there is no 1 hour in the present? And there's not even 1 second in the present, not even 1 nanosecond in the present. There is no time at all in the present. How do you resolve this difficult question, which is a real question, but nobody has thought about it, that here we are constantly living in the present, a constant now, a constant series of nows, but never involving any time. And yet, while we are in the now, we are saying, didn't I just speak to you? Didn't we just have the exercise now? Didn't I just touch this flower? Isn't it in the present? Am I not touching this flower in the present? When am I touching it? Did you not just see me touch this flower? Did you see me or you remembered it? The truth is, you remembered it. The truth is, there can be no episode in your life except through memory. Because the technical now, the technical present has no time. It cannot fit in any event that needs time. When I touch it and you see it, you are remembering the immediate past. Still past. Therefore, there is no access to past you can have except through memory. What about the future? If this is the past, what about the future? Future is nothing but an activity of hope, fear, and anticipation. There are three words in the English dictionary, and they represent three functions. And they actually mean the same thing. Hope is a positive anticipation. Fear is a negative anticipation. And anticipation is a neutral anticipation. When you anticipate something, the anticipation must happen in the now and requires time in the same way as the past, and therefore is also memory. We never realized that what we call future is also memory. What we call past is memory. What we call present is memory. There is nothing else but memory. Not being able to stay in terms of experience of consciousness on a now that extends beyond the timeless moment. Not being able, not having any access to that time on which you can hold. If you could hold time and nothing would change, then you would say, I have controlled time. You don't have that access. Time flows on. As time flows on, you remain on the timeless now. The rest is memory. Okay, so far so good. But if you are remembering, if it is memory, where did it happen that you can remember from? You can't remember something that never happened. Obviously, all that we are experiencing must have happened. Otherwise, how could we remember? How could memory play a role if nothing happened? The answer is, it did happen. That's why we remember, but didn't happen here. That we are replaying something that had happened. And the replay is what we call physical life. So physical life is not an original copy. It is a replay of a tape. You don't believe it? By that process which I was talking of earlier, by going within, you can have access to the tapes that are already there. You can replay them again at will when you like. We call them the Akashic records. We call them the predetermined life patterns. Every possible type of life or every possible type of individual has been taped and kept in a place of universal time. You can bring it down to this now, replay it, and we call living. Moment by moment, day by day, year by year. Ultimately, we were born, we are remembering this, now we are growing up, now we become old, and we die, and we suddenly realize the whole thing happened in a timeless instant. Why did it happen in a timeless instant? Because there was nothing else available except the timeless instant. The rest was created by memory. We sit here and we say, 10 years have passed. We know we are creating this experience of 10 years have passed in the timeless instant. Take an example that when you go to sleep, you can have a dream that you are in front of a very strange old building, 2,000 years old. Never seen it before. A guide is there taking you to a new historical monument discovered, 2,000 years old, never seen it before. Such strange moss is growing on it. The moon is shining on top of it. You tell the guide, who is himself an old man, how old is this? It's 2,000 years. So obviously it is so old, you can see the age of that monument. And somebody wakes you up and says, get up, you forgot something. You wake up and found that you only slept 6 minutes ago. 6 minutes ago, that ancient monument did not exist. Didn't exist anywhere at all. You had no knowledge of it. And you went to sleep had a dream and saw a monument 2,000 years old, and in 6 minutes you woke up and that memory of 2,000 years old was still there. How long did it take to create 2,000 years? No time at all. In 6 minutes, you got the experience of seeing something created ostensibly 2,000 years ago, being explained to you, and you yourself verifying with your senses it is 2,000 years old. And you woke up and found the reality that that past, that 2,000 years ago, did not require 2,000 years. In one instant of a dream sequence, you could create the past of 2,000 years. We are doing precisely that now. As we go along, which is a fallacy, but as we go along, we create our past as we go and remember it. And thereby, we grow old. We are not growing old by moving in time. We are growing old by creating a longer past day by day. We are not creating only space. Somebody traveled in a car and I said, you know, it's a nice drive. He said, yes, it's just a few miles ahead that we have to stop. I said, oh, why do you talk like this? He said, we are not going anywhere. The roads and the trees and they all coming to us. And in so many minutes, the 2 miles will come to us. We are where we were. Don't you see the whole world is coming to us? I said, don't be crazy. I'll never let you drive. What I said to that friend was truth. But we don't accept it. But if it is truth about space coming to us and flowing around us, we never change our location because we have no location in time and space. We create time and space around us. We have always been where we are. We have always been in our true home. We never left it. And yet we create these illusions around us. And the illusions move with our consciousness and create the feeling we are moving through space and we are moving through time. When we create the illusion that we are moving through time, we create the past and extend the past to show our movement into the future. Actually, we never move, even in time. It's a little deep thought, but I thought you might be interested in examining the nature of memory and remembering that the whole of human life is nothing but memory. And it happened somewhere else where you can hold time. And that's not very far away. Go one step in, you'll see where you can hold time. And review memory as you like. If you could right now, in your own mind say, well, he gave a good talk, let me replay it. And you replayed the last half an hour. Your whole concept on life will change. But you feel, no, it's gone. It can never come back. It was real. What he spoke to us was real. It is gone. You have to buy a tape to hear what happened. If you had a natural ability to replay, instant replay, the sensory perceptions you are now having, just instantly replay 5 minutes of what has happened, you will never look at the world again. A new knowledge will come, a new awareness will come of this creation, which you have never seen, and yet that is the truth. The truth is, it is just being played out. And you have the capacity inside you to replay at will. We're not doing it because our attention is not in the controls. Our attention is not at the level where these controls exist, where you can replay. We already set that tape recorder in motion. The tape is going on. We take it as real. And we are trapped. And the only way we can remember is through memory. So understand the nature of memory. In deeper metaphysical studies, you will be able to see that if you understand how consciousness operates and creates these experiences, not only will you find answers to all your questions, you will find all the contradictions anybody has ever pointed out in two different religious texts to disappear. There is no contradiction. The contradictions are arising because of our failure to understand what is happening at different levels of consciousness. Whoever has had access to different levels of consciousness will realize that when you plant one truth from one level to another, we create contradictions. If there is only one consciousness, then you bring it here in the illusion where there are many. Actually, we are one. Let's try to live like we are one. We are experiencing many. We brought a truth from another level of consciousness and trying to impose it here, a contradiction takes place. But at the same level, there is no contradiction. And understanding different levels of consciousness removes all the contradictions and gives you all the answers. You will never have a question again. This realization of the truth within answers all questions of all kinds. So see what the beauty of going within is. What wonderful rewards there are. So let's go in again. Let's try. Now you notice that the mind is constantly thinking. That is one of the obstacles to staying behind the eyes. One of you pointed out, others have known it. Therefore, these mystics have devised the method called mantra, repetition of words. It's a very clever way they devise this technique. One of the most useful techniques devised in meditation is the use of repetitive words in order to control the mind. Excellent device, because it is based upon the knowledge that the mind will always think. And for educated people, it always thinks in words. Always keeps on repeating your own educated language. And the more you think, the more you speak. You are constantly speaking. In fact, you are speaking so much that I could give you a little bit of surprise with a new bit of knowledge, which may startle you, that when you look at these flowers, you say, I have seen the flowers. You have only seen them when you have said to yourself, I have seen the flowers. Did you know that? It's news for you. Now watch out for next time. That when you look at the flowers, you have not seen the flowers till your mind says, ah, there are the flowers. Or say something to that effect. That the speaking mind translates every sense perception into a perception. That the sense perception does not become perception for us till the mind has translated it and said, this is it. Interprets it in words. That's how we are so situated. Therefore, our real self, the soul, does not need any other perception to see the illusion of this world except listening. If it can listen, it can see, hear, touch, do everything. Because the rest the mind is doing. When the mind can speak out everything, all you need to do is to listen and the whole world becomes reality. Therefore, the characteristic of the soul is the power to listen. And the characteristic of the mind is the power to speak. The second characteristic of the power of the soul is to see. But that comes later. Listening and speaking can create the whole of this physical universe. Now, since the mind speaks all the time, take advantage of it. Make it speak what you like, not what the mind likes. The mind distracts us in meditation because it speaks what the mind likes, not what we want the mind to speak. Force the mind to speak what you want. That's the purpose of mantra. Mantra is to introduce new words which you can supplant, which you can pump into this pipeline so that the new words of mantra are forced into the mind's audible stream and the other words the mind is creating by thought are squeezed out and you keep on hearing the mantra instead of hearing other thoughts. Many of you have a mantra. Is that right? Please raise your hands, those who know a mantra which can be repeated. Please use this in the next exercise. When you sit there, repeat. Those who do not have a mantra, please create one temporarily for this exercise. Express in words your admiration and love for any word, any language. Just create a short phrase and repeat that phrase mechanically again and again in this next exercise. So all of you now have a mantra. Speak with the mind, not with the tongue. Because we are not, the tongue can keep on saying, people, I see people speaking the Hare Ram, Hare Ram. In India is very common. Now if Hare Ram is a good mantra, they say Hare Ram, Hare Ram. And the mind keeps on saying, it's lunchtime, it's going. The mantra is not Hare Ram, the mantra is it's lunchtime. Mantra is what the mind is speaking. Not what the tongue is speaking. So the words of mantra have to be repeated by the mind. And when the mind speaks those words, they should be spoken loud so you can hear. They should be loud enough So you can hear nothing else in the head, but not with the tongue, not with the mouth. Mouth should be shut and only the head, the mind should speak the mantra and speak loud, clear, deliberate with attention. The more clearly you announce that mantra, pronounce that mantra, enunciate that mantra, the more clearly you do it, the more your attention is drawn there in trying to listen to what it is saying. And the more quickly you will draw attention to the third eye center behind the eyes. Please start. 5. Open your eyes. Yes.
Something has come to me that it's very, very hard to put into words because it's an experience. And it's quite direct. So bear with me if I phrase it clumsily. I see the light, okay, in my body and within. And the eye that's seeing it, it is not a physical eye. It is not a spiritual eye. It is an eye that I don't want to call it capital I, the letter. Maybe it's small I, but I would emphasize small I. It's like the essence of an individual personal I. This is all intellect now, trying to describe something that isn't intellectual. Like a point of light that has no dimensions. And it's seeing the light that it itself is radiating. And it too has a source, you know, and like there's an urge or a hunger or a pulling to that source from where that's coming, that there seems to be some kind of a barrier there. But that's the I that is experienced as being single and not just like the eye, the imaginary eyeball or third eye or inner eye. It's like really hard to put into words.
Well, when you said and quoted, when thine eye be single, thy whole body shall be filled with light, it is reference to that eye. Not reference to the third eye. It is not reference to imagination. So, although you say you described clumsily, I thought you did a good job verbalizing the experience. Follow it up. The source of that light is within that light. The light that you saw, the source of that light is within that light, because the eye is within that light too. Right? Any question at this time? Yes. If you can hear a sound inside, you don't need any mantra. There's a natural sound emanating from the same source of light. The light within, which is our own self. The light of the self and the vibration, the rhythm and the sound resonance of that self. If you can listen to that, you don't need any mantra. That is the best mantra. Yes.
I thought great master said that only a certain amount of time should be listening the sound, and the other part should be doing the simmer.
Yes, for practice. Till you get hooked onto the sound, you don't need simran after that. It's only in the beginning, initial stages, that you have to divide your time to practice simran, to concentrate your attention behind the eyes, and to listen to the sound, to practice getting hooked onto it. When the sound becomes loud and continuous enough to hold you and pull you, you don't need any simran. Okay, we have a break for lunch, and after lunch we come and continue these exercises and go deeper into the great treasures that lie behind the eyes within each one of us, placed by the Creator Himself, not by any individual. Thank you. Well, friends, we have assembled after lunch. I hope you enjoyed the lunch. I enjoyed it. It didn't look like it was imagination at all. I wanted to make it clear for those who may have any question about it, that what I am sharing with you is what my great master shared with me. It is not a religion, new or old. It is not a cult. It is not a particular philosophy. It is not a particular group, not a society. It is none of these things. It is at best a new approach at looking at your own self and thereby to see the validity of the truth that you have read in any religion, any scriptures, anywhere in the world. What I am suggesting to you, you can practice without changing your religion, without changing your nationality, without changing your culture, without changing your language, without changing anything except your attitude towards your own mind. That's all. And that suggestion to change your attitude towards your own mind and have a more positive attitude towards your own soul is nothing new. It's always been there and has been the foundation of all religions in the world. The fact I suggest to you, go within, is nothing new at all. Every religion in the world, every spiritual discipline in the world has said the truth is within and go within. Therefore, there's nothing new I'm sharing with you. It's all old stuff. All I'm saying is, having known the old stuff, having got it with us for so long, we didn't apply it and didn't find out the truth. We had the written scriptures. We had written texts of the truth. We could not make use of them. Here is an opportunity to go within, get the answers, find out what all those truths are about. When you are within and you find out the truth of your own true self, everything looks clear in what has been written in the past. Otherwise, if you want to intellectually, mentally try to interpret, you'll find a lot of difficulties and a lot of distortions, a lot of versions, a lot of contradictions. But the direct practical experience of truth within removes all doubts. People have doubts, but the doubts are there so long as they have inner experience. When you get inner experience, as you have more and more inner experience, it reduces your doubt, does not create any more doubts. But if you try to interpret and prepare intellectually in order to go within, you cannot resolve the doubts. One set of doubts will be removed, another set will come up. One set of questions will be answered, a new set will be ready. So the best thing is, why keep on debating about it? Go in and see it. But the mind has trapped us, especially the intellectual part of our mind, which we have inherited in a society that is placing think as the highest thing. Mind, think, civilized, act in a certain way, this culture, that has inhibited our true freedom to explore truth as we like. So here is to break some shackles and not debate all the time. You can spend a whole lifetime debating till I get this answer, till I'm sure I'm not going to do anything. Such a person dies without doing anything. There is a story told in India of a man, a professor. Professor, we call him, because intellectuals are often professors in our country. So a professor was walking and he didn't watch. He was thinking of his intellectual theories. And there was a small well, and that he could not see the well. It didn't have a parapet wall. It was just one of those village wells we have for water, drawing water by the villagers. He wasn't seeing it. So he fell into it. He fell into the well. And fortunately for him, the water was shallow, so he didn't die. But he swam and he was sinking and he didn't know what to do. And he was groaning and shouting and howling. And a man came outside. He heard his groans. And he said, "Boy, you've fallen into the well." So he quickly ran and brought a rope, so that with the rope, this man in the well will be able to come out. So he lowered the rope and he said, "Hold on to this rope. Try to pull up yourself. I'll also pull you up. We'll both, with our energies and strength, get you out of this well. Don't worry." The professor said, "Before I catch the rope, tell me, how did I fall in the well?" He says, "Look, there'll be plenty of time to see when you come out." He says, "No. And how am I sure that I won't fall in again? And how am I sure that you will not leave me halfway when I'm trying to climb the rope? Give me all the answers before I catch the rope." The man said, "Look, there's plenty of time. I have heard you groaning and growling and in pain and suffering in the well. And I have lowered this rope for you to climb up, to get out of the well. And all these answers can be tackled when you come out. See what happened to you." He says, "No, I will not catch it. First of all, convince me that I will not fall again into the well, that you will not let me down." He went on arguing. So the man said, "Okay, take the rope and you come out on your own." And he walked away. We can make our life like that, that we are in a well and trying to debate. How did we get in here? How are we sure we'll be able to get out? How are we sure there is a master? How do we know this is the reality? How can we be sure we have to go within? How can we be sure We can keep on asking and debating and then die and start all over again. That's like the man in the well. So there is a point when we have to say, let's take a chance. We know we are in a terrible state. We want to get out of this mess. Let's grab what we can, which looks the best. This is a thin rope. Okay, when somebody gives a bigger one, we'll change over. But let's get on to what we have. So this practical philosophy of trying out something and trying to get out of the mess is what the perfect living masters offer us. They are like the man outside who throws the rope for the man in the well. These perfect living masters who are living in the light and beauty and joy of everlasting life in their true home come and see us in the well of this temporary illusion. And they say, there is a way. Here is the way you can get out of it. And they lower the rope. And they say, hold on to it and come out and be like us. These perfect living masters don't want to make us better people for this place. They don't say, come on, here's a can of paint. Paint the well, it'll look better for you for the rest of your stay there. They don't want to improve the condition of the well. They have come to get you out of the well. Therefore, they say, if you want to come out, you can come out and be free like us. That is why a simile is given about these perfect living masters, that there is a philosopher's stone called Paras. We call it Paras. Paras, when you touch iron with it, becomes gold. Have you heard of that? The philosopher's stone, when you touch iron with that stone, it turns into gold. The mystics say, the mystics are like the philosopher's stone with one difference. When you touch the iron with the philosopher's stone of a mystic, it does not convert it into gold, it makes him into the mystic. It makes him into the philosopher's stone. The mystics don't make us ordinary people into better people. They make us like themselves, identical with themselves. So therefore, what they promise is what they have. They don't promise anything less, that we are at this pedestal, now you come to second rank. They say, come and take our place. Be with us. Exactly what they have, they share. So this is a beautiful opportunity. And one should not miss on it if one gets it. When we are ready, a mystic will appear in our life. I want you to study. Because I have gone around the world to so many countries, so many times. I must have gone around the world 40, 50 times and been to so many countries. And I meet seekers in every country. And I have not come across a country where there are seekers and there is no master coming. I have not come across a seeker who really, within his own heart, sought, tried to find within himself and did not run into a person who was enlightened automatically. Therefore, it is not that you have to race towards somebody to get it. You have to race towards your own self. And by coincidence and circumstances, the masters will appear, your friends will appear. They'll appear in a strange form. They'll appear in a form that you can trust. They'll appear in a form where you will feel, yes, this is like me, therefore I can trust. They will not appear in a supernatural form. They'll appear in a human form, in so human a form that you can relate to them. See, yes, they can talk like us. They walk like us. They are as weak as we are. They're just like us. Therefore, we can be friends. They will not come and show their perfection here, even if they are perfect, because we are afraid of perfection. We don't make friends with perfect people. Did you know that? They're afraid. Too perfect a person, wow, I'm frightened. But a person like me, who's as ordinary as I am, good, I'll shake your hand and wave. If you're good, it's good. If you're not good, we are together in this game. That's the kind of person we like to be friend with. Therefore, these masters come up to our level. When we find them, that means when they find us, we are amazed at their capacity to come to our level, to talk our language, to relate to our idiom, to think of our values, and to come down to those values in order that we may be friends. Then they take us up to the highest values after that. So this is not a cult or a religion or anything. This is the opportunity to seek within, and not being able to go within, to find the opportunity of a friend who temporarily is outside, but permanently is inside. And in that image which comes outside, we get the means of going within our own self and find the truth. and prove to us our own religion and prove to us our own spiritual path. So you have to change nothing except to practice what you have been learning in the past. Having said all this, we get back to the true path, which is within. It's a good rule of thumb to remember. If you don't know which direction to go, go within. It's a very, very simple rule. Because going within does not confuse us as much as confusing going east or west or right or left. Therefore, whenever in doubt, go within and get the answer. And you will know whether to go right or left also by going within. Therefore, going within should be practiced on a daily basis. We should practice with our own beloved, with our own master, with our own guru, with our own spiritual teacher, with our own friend, with our anyone who in whom we have full faith and trust. We should put that picture in front of us and have a feeling of love and devotion, because nothing will pull us more than love and devotion. That comes from the highest level. I mentioned to you different level. In the physical level, there is no love. Nobody who's a physical machine, you put a lump of meat here, it cannot love. It's not possible. It can only add on matter. Matter adds matter. And the only worthwhile thing in this physical world is physical wealth. The richer you are physically, the more powerful you are, the more purchasing power you have, and more greenbacks you have, the more you can strut around and say, I'll buy up this, I'll buy up this. This currency of greenbacks and dollars and money counts only here, nowhere else. You go to the higher level of consciousness, the astral level. Money is useless, body is useless, everything is useless. There your actions count. If you have done good actions here, you are rich there. You may not be rich here. You may be poor here, but good actions develop a bank balance in the astral region. But if you go to a still higher universal mental level, where the whole of this seen world, the world in time and space is being created and floated and goes constantly around. If you go to that universal state of the Trikuti, the three worlds, above the three worlds in the Brahma, where the creation takes place. If you go there, actions don't count either. Money doesn't count either. That's not the currency. Intention counts. The mental intention that creates all karma, that creates all life patterns. If you have good intentions, you have a good bank balance. You have good intentions here, you are building up a bank balance there. But when you go there, this money won't count, actions won't count, but your intentions gathered will still count and you are rich there. But if you go to pure spiritual regions above time, above space, none of these count. Neither intentions, nor actions, nor your money and wealth, physical wealth here. Only love counts. If you have experienced love, the more love you have experienced and shared, the richer you are. So love is the currency of the spiritual world. So any spiritual discipline, any spiritual practice that is devoid of love is no spiritual practice. You have to go beyond Brahm, par Brahm. You have to go to par Brahm and start from there to have the spiritual experience of love and devotion. Somebody said to great master, that master, there are many yogis who have come to see you and they are really evolved people. They can go out of body. They can go to highest regions. Some have even seen the Akashic records. Great master laughed. He said, very good, but my path starts from par Brahm, where it's the path of love. Have they touched that? He didn't say my path ends there. He says my path starts from there. It starts from the region of love and goes to universality, to oneness. Not mental oneness, not mental universality, but spiritual. Where consciousness itself per se exists and there's no mind to spread it out. So this beautiful path is based upon love. So all the mechanics I have talked of in the morning, sit behind the eyes and take imaginary desserts and smell imaginary flowers and do this and do that is of no avail on the spiritual path. It's only a means to reach the place where you can meditate. It is not meditation. Meditation is to sit there and enjoy the love and devotion for the beloved. If you cannot sit behind the eyes and have an experience of love and devotion, you are not doing true meditation. So love and devotion is the essential part of this whole spiritual path that I am talking about. Without love and devotion, there is nothing. And love is something that comes from there. This physical matter has certain properties, which we can see its inertia, gravity, certain laws that the physical matter follows. These physical laws only apply to physical matter. When you have an imaginary body, it doesn't have weight, doesn't take on calories, you can feast on those imaginary dishes as much as you like, it doesn't follow the laws of the physical world. The imaginary body follows its own laws. It still follows the laws of time. It still follows the laws of cause and effect. It still follows sensory laws, but does not follow the laws of the physical. But when you go to the causal, it doesn't even follow the sensory laws. It goes beyond that. When you go to the spiritual, it doesn't follow any of these laws. It has its own law. Now, when you go to the spiritual form, just like there are property characteristics in the physical body, there are characteristics in the spiritual self. And those characteristics are love, beauty, joy, faith, intuition, hunch. These are not acquired traits. These are natural. If somebody says, how can we learn how to love? The answer is you can't learn. You already have it. You have learned your lesson when you were created. When you are created as a soul, irrespective of whether you are in the physical planet or not, you learned your full lesson on love. Because we are made of the very substance, the characteristic, the quality of which is love. Consciousness per se, without the coverings, is love. Consciousness in its totality, without the coverings, is God. God is love because consciousness is love. When consciousness is not hindered by the mind, love is automatic. Intuition and instantaneous knowledge is automatic. You don't have to learn it. If you unlearn the lessons of the mind imposed upon yourself, the learning is already there and automatically. People get surprised and tell me how pleased they were when they found through meditation that the questions they were looking to get answers, the questions when they disappeared, the answers were already there. Answer did not float in. Questions floated in. We raised questions, but we didn't speak out the answers. We only spoke the questions. And when the questions disappeared, the tie-up with the mind was loosened, the answers were already there. They didn't have to be heard. We already knew the answers. We already know the answers today. Today, you know all the answers to all your questions, but they're covered up by the questions of the mind. So when the mind gets out of the way, the answers are given by that knowledge is given by that self, which itself has the property of containing this knowledge and containing this love. So remember the spontaneity, the intuition, the love, the beauty, the joy that brings things together, that integrates you, that makes you feel whole and one. Those are natural properties of the soul, of the spirit self. They don't have to be learned or acquired. Look at that painting again. Beautiful trees and colors. And we look at it with one glance, we enjoy it. If I were to take that painting down with the permission of this hotel and take a pair of scissors and start cutting it into little, very neat, exact squares. I make 1-inch squares. And I put the heap of 1-inch squares on this table, I can tell you the painting is still on the table. But you won't see it. If I tell you, you don't see the painting, see all the squares. If you see all the squares, then you've seen the whole painting. And you can each one of you come up and pick up square by square, one after the other, see all of them, and still never see the painting. Where is the painting gone? Why can't you see when the whole painting is sitting on the table? The painting is gone because it could only be seen as a whole, integrated, one. When you cut it up into pieces, it destroys the experience that is in the painting. It destroys the integrity and the joy and the aesthetics of that painting, which can only come up if it is whole. That's what we are doing with life. If we could see life as a whole, I'm not talking of physical life, creation as a whole. It is so beautiful. It is so perfect. You can do nothing to improve it. But when we cut it up with the scissors of time and space, here and now, then and now, here and there, when we cut into time and space, into days and moments, and cut it into different places and try to look at life with these small segments, it looks ugly. We can't even see it. time and space are being used to cut up into small squares, this beautiful life, it doesn't look like life at all, seen through these little pieces. We can put these pieces together when we have the vision to put them together, which is spiritual vision. When we are without the mind, with our own spirit, we can see things in their wholeness, in their oneness. It's beautiful. It's wonderful. It's the same thing we are seeing. It's not that we are going somewhere else to see. All the great future, all the great visions that we see, and all the beautiful light and sound that we talk of, is not somewhere else. It's here. Here and now with us. But we have lost our ability, our faculties to see it, and we have clouded them by these covers. And when we remove these covers one after the other, we can see them. Supposing we had a nice light bulb here. Very beautiful incandescent light bulb. It would shine beautifully. If you put on top of it a little rotating thing that they use in the discos and what are those places? It goes, strobe light, it throws light all over and goes all around. If you cover the lamp with little holes and they go round and round, you say, wow, this beautiful light, it is going round and round. The light never went round and round. It's the outer cover that is going round and round in which the holes are there. Then if we cover it with a thick blanket, you say, oh, light has gone out. Light has not gone out. It's still there. It's covered up by the thick blanket, by the big paper bag. You know those brown paper bags which we get to buy from the grocery store? When we put the brown paper bag, we say, light has gone out. Light is still there. We are doing the same thing to us ourselves. Look at this paper bag. This body is the paper bag. We can't see the light inside because we're covering it up. Light has not gone anywhere. We don't have to find it or awaken it or light it up or put the candle on, the switch on. It's on. It's illumined. But the paper bag is not letting us see it. When we take this paper bag off, we see the light moving. It is not moving. The mind is making it move. The mind is creating these illusions. It's not broken into pieces. The senses are making it break into pieces. The mind is giving it change and movement. When we take the senses and the mind off of our own self, we find we were lighted up as ever all the time, and we didn't know it. How can you take this paper bag off? If there was a light here, I just pull it down. This is hard to pull down because when I pull down, the very lamp seems to break inside. Therefore, to have the experience of pulling this paper bag, this body, this physical body off in order to see the light in, either you die, the body goes, whatever is left must be the lighted one, or you find some other way. The mystic said, you don't have to die to get this. You can die while living. Why don't you experience what death will give you while you are still here? Because you can know what happens to people who die. Haven't you seen them? What happens? When they die, their consciousness is pulled. First they feel their hands and feet are going. If you see a person dying slowly, the consciousness first leaves the extremities. Then it leaves the center part. But the brain is not dead. The person can still speak. And as the process of loss of consciousness grows towards the head, the heart stops beating. The person is dead, but is still knowing what's happening. When the brain is dead, we say he's gone. So really what we are doing is to pull the attention from the extremities back to the point in the brain. And when it goes out from there, we say the person is dead. How about trying it while alive? Why not put your attention on the third eye center, withdraw your attention there to the point you become unaware of your extremities. You don't know where your hands are. And it's very easy. Those of you who have done meditation, if you put your attention here, gradually you will feel that the hands, you don't know where they are. How did you put them like this or like this? You have to open your eyes. Sometimes you feel that you put your hands like this and sat down. You're not sure. Because the attention has gone there, you're not even sure. You open and you find the hands are like this. You become so unaware. As this unawareness of extremities in the body goes on, at a point, you don't know if you have a body. Then you don't know if you have a body, but you know you are there. And who are you? And the light shines. The same process is repeated for the astral and the causal bodies. Ultimately, the full light shines and all the covers are removed, and yet you go back and descend through the same thing, in the same illusion, and get up and say, I saw it. I know it. It happened to me. It happened to me personally before I died in this body. This is called dying while living. And St. Paul says, I die daily. That's what he means, not physical death. This process of dying while living is the easiest way to see light within. And to concentrate your attention at the natural center where it is in the wakeful state is the easiest way to experience death while living. So dying while living is the answer to the problem, how can we get the light without first leaving the body and not being able to come back and tell. That is why these people, the enlightened ones who got the light within themselves, they could tell and guide us while they were still living in the same body. If they died and came in another body, if every time a mystic who got enlightenment had to actually physically die, then be born as a baby, then grow up, and then say, come on, I want to tell you what happened in the past life. This is a crazy child. Send him to school. He needs more education.